So let's continue looking at the transportation of materials across the membrane, looking at the passive movement. The passive movement of materials is governed by two principal physiology laws, Starling's law and Fick's law. These two laws are based off of gradient principles and the necessity to have energy within the environment to move things passively across the membrane based off of the quote-unquote thickness of the membrane, or how much area we have to exchange materials. That's one of the reasons why we talked about earlier the microvilli that we see on cells that will be involved with high amounts of absorption and excretion. Starling's law is based off of bulk flow principles, and this simply states that materials are going to move based off of the hydrostatic and osmotic pressure differences across the membrane, where we're going to move from areas of high hydrostatic pressure to areas of low hydrostatic pressure. The areas of high hydrostatic pressure is going to propel fluids away from that area by drawing water away from that area. We will see Starling's law come into play when we talk about osmosis and osmotic movement of materials. Fick's law, on the other hand, is a distinction of the rate at which materials are going to move, in which it stipulates that the rate of diffusion is based off of a proportionality to the total surface area and an inverse proportionality to the distance that it has to exchange. Meaning that the more surface area that I have, the faster exchange will take place, the greater the distance I have to move, the slower the exchange will take place. When we think about the anatomy of the alveoli within the lungs, we're basing this anatomy off of Fick's law's principles. When we look at the anatomy of the capillaries, it's based off of Fick's law principles, where we're going to diminish the amount of distance that we have and increase the total surface area of exchange that we have. So let's look at the two principal mechanisms that we have for passive movements, diffusion and facilitated diffusion. And we have to think about what kinds of things are going to passively move through the membrane, and which things do we need to have some sort of pore that things will be able to pass through. So things that are going to be able to diffuse directly through the membrane are things that are going to be lipid-soluble or excessively small. Things that have to go through some sort of pore are going to be things that are either large or things that are hydrophilic, lipid-insoluble. So when we talk about osmosis being the passive movement of water, it's not due to diffusion, it's due to facilitated diffusion. So let's take a look at diffusion. And so watch the movement of the materials as we head across the membrane. So we have greater concentration outside the membrane and lesser concentration inside the membrane, which means that materials will slowly start to move through the membrane. And we continue to move across the membrane until we have an equal concentration of materials across the membrane. Now, once we get an equal concentration of materials across the membrane, we will still have movement. However, the movement will be equally both in and out as long as the concentrations, that is the amount of those materials, stay the same. And it's about the concentration of materials, not about the absolute amount of materials. So now let's take a look at facilitated diffusion. And you'll notice the same type of pattern of movement, but this time we have to go through a pore within the membrane as we cannot get directly through the membrane. So as you notice, we're moving from areas of high concentration to areas of low concentration. And using the channel pores to do this. And once again, we go until we are at an equilibrium of concentration of materials inside and outside of the membrane. And just like we saw with diffusion, we'll still have exchange. However, it's not going to be a directional exchange. And so what we say is that once we are at equal concentrations or equal tonicity, then we have exchange, but the net movement is zero. And that concept of tonicity leads us to the next bit of passive movement that will take place, and that is the osmotic movement, or the movement of water due to osmotic drive and hydrostatic pressures. This is going to dictate how water moves across the selective permeable membrane through the aquaporin channels, in which we always have flow from areas of high water concentration to areas of low water concentration. And we can only do this with access to aquaporin, the water pore within the membrane. And why is that? If you think about it, water is not lipid soluble. And since water is not lipid soluble, it cannot go through the membrane itself. It has to have an access point to get across the membrane. When we talk about this movement, we talk about it based off of water concentration, but in actuality, what we're talking about is salt concentration. That is, salt is going to attract water into an area, and it's based off of a key statement. And the key statement is water will follow salt, and salt will follow water. In this statement, what we're saying is that we're going to move water and move salts across the membrane until the concentrations are equal to each other. In this, we have two designations. The two designations we have is the high water concentration is hypotonic or hypoosmotic, and a low concentration of water is hypertonic or hyperosmotic. And so the flow that we're going to be looking at here is that we're going to flow from hypotonic or hypoosmotic to hypertonic, hyperosmotic. That is, we're going to flow from areas of low salt to areas of high salt in an attempt to get the water levels equal to each other. But there's a problem with this, and the problem is that we're never going to get to an equal water within the cells of the body until an apoptotic signal is hit. That is, too much water is going to flow one way or the other, causing issues for the cells. And we'll talk about some of these issues when we get together in class. So let's take a look at PERS. So when we're isotonic, we have equal concentrations inside and outside the cell. And so with equal concentrations inside and outside the cell, there's not going to be any movement of materials. And so the cell stays its normal shape and its normal size. But what happens if all of a sudden we put this cell into a hypertonic solution? So we have greater concentrations of salt outside than we have inside. All of a sudden, the cell starts to lose water, and the cell is losing 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 water, and the cell is becoming desiccated within the hypertonic solution. This is what happens when we have a dehydration event taking place. Now what happens if instead of being hypertonic, we become hypotonic? And it can continue to absorb water into the cell until the cell membrane itself cannot withstand the hydrostatic pressure within the cell and will ultimately burst. these osmotic conditions. And so we're in an isotonic solution, and notice that there's no change in the cells whatsoever. And then we're going to slowly change it to a hypertonic solution and watch what happens to the cells. The cells slowly start to shrivel as water is exiting the cell. And then we're going to go ahead and put it into a hypotonic solution here. So you notice within the hypertonic solution, we're still shrinking. We go back to isotonic, the cells will go ahead and rebound. This is kind of what happens when you start drinking the electrolyte solutions after exercise. Now what happens if we go hypotonic? What happens if you decide to drink distilled water? Watch what happens to the cells here. The cells are continually bringing in water, and then we get a hydrostatic lysis of the cell, that is, the cell actually bursts. And so let's take a look and see what happens and why this